Vampire Academic, Chapter 15. Manson delivered. He found me the next day before school. He was carrying a box of books. "I got them," he said. "Hurry and take them before you get in trouble for talking to me." He handed them over and I grunted, "You're heavy." "Christian gave you these?" "Yeah." Managed to talk to him without anyone noticing. He's got kind of an attitude. Did you even notice that? "Yeah, I noticed." I rewarded Manson with a smile that he ate up. "Thanks, this means a lot." I hauled the loot up to my room, fully aware of how weird it was that someone who hated to study as much as I did was about to get buried in dusty crap from the 14th century. When I opened the first book, though, I saw that these must be reprints of reprints of reprints, probably because anything that old could have long since fallen apart. Shifting through the books, I discovered they fell into three categories: books written by people after Stein Waldemix had died, books written by other people when he was still alive, and one diary of sorts written by him. What had Manson said about primary and secondary sources? Those last two groups were the ones I wanted. Whoever had reprinted these had reworded the books, though, so that I don't have to read old English or anything. Or rather, Russian, I supposed. Saint Waldemic had lived in the old country. Today, I healed the mother of Sava, who has long since suffered from sharp pains within her stomach. Her malady is now gone. But God has not allowed me to do such a thing lightly. I'm weak and dizzy, and the madness is trying to leak into my head. I thank God every day for shadow-kissed Anna, for without her, I could surely not be able to endure. Anna again, and shadow-kissed. He talked about her a lot, among other things. Most of the time, he wrote long sermons, just like what I could hear in church. Super boring. But other times, the book read just like a diary, recapping that he did each day. And if it really was not just a lot of crap, he healed all the time, sick people, injured people, even plants. He brought dead crops back to life when people were starving. Sometimes he could have flowers bloom just for the hell of reading on. I found out that it was a good thing old Wald had Anna around, because he was pretty messed up. The more he used his powers, the more they started to get to him. He could get irrationally angry and sad. He blamed it on demons and stupid stuff like that. But it was obvious he suffered from depression. Once he admitted in his diary, he tried to kill himself. Anna stopped him. Later, browsing through the books written by the guy who knew Waldemic, I read, and many things it miraculous too. The blessed Waldemic shows over others, Moray and Dampier's blokes, to him and listen to his words, happy just to near him. Some says it is madness that touches him and no spread, but most adore him and could do anything he asked, such in the way God marks his favorites. And if such moments are followed by halcations and despair, it is a small sacrifice for the amount of good and leadership he can show among the people. It sounded a lot like what the priest had said, but it seems more than just a winning personality. People ordered him, could do anything he asked. Yes, Waldemic had used compulsion on his followers, I was certain. A lot of Moray had in those days before it was banned, but they don't use it on Moray or Dampiers. They could not. Only Lisa could. I shut the book and leaned back against my bed. Waldemic healed plants and animals. He could use compulsion on a massive scale, and by all accounts, using those sorts of powers had made him crazy and depressed. Added to it all, taking it that such weird was that everyone kept describing his guardian as shadow-kissed. That expression had bugged me ever since I first heard it. "You are shadow-kissed. You have to take care of her." Miss Crab had shouted those words at me, her hands clenching my shirt and jerking me towards her. It had happened on a night 2 years ago when I could been inside the main part of the upper school to return a book. It was nearly past curfew and the halls were empty. I could hear the loud commotion and that Miss Crab had come tearing around the corner looking frantic and wild-eyed. She shoved me into a wall, still gripping me. Do you understand? I know enough self-defense that I could have probably pushed her away, but my shock kept me frozen. No. They are coming for me. They will come for her. Who? Lisa. You have to protect her. The more she uses it, the worse it will get. Stop her, Rose. Stop her before they notice and take her away too. Get her out of here. I, what do you mean? Get her out of, you mean the academic? Yes, you have to leave. You're bound. It is up to you. Take her away from this place. Her words were crazy. No one left the academic, yet she had held me there and shouted into my eyes. I began to feel strange. A fuzzy feeling clouded my mind. What she did suddenly sounded very reasonable, like the most reasonable thing in the world. Yes, I needed to take Lisa away. Take her. Feet pounded in the hallway and a group of guardians rounded the corner. I don't recognize them. They were not from the school. They peered her off me, restraining her. While thrashing, someone asked me if I was okay, but I could only keep shouting at Miss Crab. Don't let her use the power, she screamed. Save her from herself. The guardians had later explained to me that she was not well and had been taken to a place where she could recover. She could be safe and cared for. They assured me she could recover, only she had not. Back in the present, I started at the books and tried to put it all together. Lisa, Miss Crab, Stein Waldemar. What was I supposed to do? Someone grabbed at my door and I jerked out of my memories. One had visited me. No one has visited me, not even staff, since my suspension. When I opened the door, I saw Mansion in the hall. Twice in one day? I asked. And how could you even get up here? He flashed with his easy smile. Someone put it a lit match in one of the bathroom's garbage cans. Damn shame. That stuff kind of busy. Come on, I'm springing you. I shook my head. Setting fires was apparently a new sign of affection. Christian had done it and now Manson. Sorry, no saving me tonight. If I get caught, Lisa's orders. I shut up and let him smuggle me out of the building. He took me over the moratorium and miraculously got me in and up to her room unseen. I wondered if there was a distracting bathroom fire in this building too. Inside her room, I found a party in full swing. Lisa, Kamala, Carrie, Aaron, and few other royals sat around laughing, listening to loud music, and passing around bottles of whiskey. No Mia, no Jess. Natalie, I noticed a few moments later, sat apart from the group, clearly unsure how to act around them. Her awkwardness was totally obvious. Lisa stumbled to her feet, the fuzzy feeling in her bond indicating she had been drinking for a while. Rose, she turned to Manson with a dazzling smile. You delivered. He swept her an over-the-top bow. I'm at your command. I hoped he'd done it for the thrill of it and not because of any compulsion. Lisa slung an arm around my waist and pulled me down with the others. Join the festivities. What are we celebrating? I don't know. You escaped tonight? A few of others held up plastic cups, cheering and toasting me. Alexander Badika poured two more cups, handing them to Manson and me. I took mine with a smile, all the while feeling uneasy about the night's turn of events. Not so long ago, I could have welcomed a party like this and could have downed my drink in 30 seconds. Too much bothered me this time, though, like the fact that royals were treating Lisa like a goddess, like how none of them seems to remember that I had been accused of being a bloodhore. Like how Lisa was completely unhappy despite her smiles and laughter. Where do you get the whiskey? I asked. Mr. Nagy, Aaron said. He sat very close to Lisa. Everyone knew Mr. Nagy drank all the time after school and kept a stash on campus. He continuously used new hiding places and students continuously found them. Lisa leaned against Aaron's shoulder. Aaron helped me break into his room and take them. He had them hidden in the bottom of the paint closest. The others laughed and Aaron gazed at her with complete and utter worship. Amusingly, I realized she had not had to use any compulsion on him. He was just that crazy for her. He always had been. "Why are not you drinking?" Manson asked me a little while later, speaking quietly into my ear. I glanced down at my cup, half surprised to see it full. "I don't know. I guess I don't like guardians to drink around their charges." "She is not your charge yet. You are not on duty. You won't be for a long time." "Since when did you get so reasonable?" "I don't really think I was all that responsible. But I was thinking about what Drimit had said about balancing fun and obligation. It just seems wrong to let myself go wild when Lisa was in such a vulnerable state lately." Wiggling out of my tight spot between her and Manson, I walked over and sat beside Natalie. "Hey, Nat, you're quiet tonight." He held a cup full of as mine. "So are you?" I laughed softly. "I guess so." She titled her head, watching Manson and the Royals like they were some sort of science experiment. They could have consumed a lot more whiskey since I have arrived, and the silliness had shot up considerably. "Weird, huh? You used to be the center of attention. Now she is." I blinked in surprise. I had not considered it like that. "I guess so." "Hey, Rose," said Alexander, nearly spilling his drink as he walked over to me. "What was it like? What was what like? Letting someone feed off you?" The others felt quiet, a sort of anticipation, settling them over. "She don't do that," said Lisa in a warning voice. "I told you." Yeah, I know. Nothing happened with Jess and Ruff. But you guys did it, right? Well, you were gone." "Let it go," said Lisa. Compulsion worked best with direct eye contact, and his attention was focused on me, not her. "I mean, it is cool and everything. You guys did what you had to do, right? It is not like you're a feeder. I just want to know what it was like." "Denali let me bite her once," she said. "It don't feel like anything." There was a collective eve from among the girls. Sex and blood with Dampier was dirty. Between Moroi, it was cannibalistic. "You're such a liar," said Camley. "No, I'm serious. It was just a small bite. She don't get high like the feeders. Did you?" He put his arm around my shoulder. "Did you like it?" Lisa's face went still and pale. Alcohol muted the full force of her feeling, but I could read enough to know how she felt. Dark, scared through Vigdil into me, underscored with anger. She usually have a good grip on her temper, unlike me, but I could see it flare up before. Once it had happened at a party very similar to this one, just a few weeks after Miss Crab had been taken away. Greek Dekshovak, a distant cousin of Natalie, had held a party in his room. His parents apparently know someone who throws someone. Because he had one of the biggest rooms in the dorm room, he could be friends with Lisa's brother before the accident and had been more than happy to take Andre's little sister into his social fold. Greek had also been happy to take me in, and the two of us had been all over each other that night. For a spurphone like me, being with the Royal Moroi Senior was a huge rush. I drank a lot that night, but still managed to keep an eye on Lisa. She always wore on edge of anxiety around these people, but no one really noticed because she could interact with them so well. My heavy bus kept a lot of her feelings from me, but as long as she looked okay, I don't worry. Mid-kiss, Greg suddenly broke away and looked at something over my shoulder. We both sat in the same chair with me on his lap, and I cranked my neck to see what it is. He shook his head with a sort of amused expression. Vad bought a feeder. I followed his gaze to where Vad Oda stood with his arms around a fraggle girl about my age. She was human and pretty, with wavy blonde hair and proclaimed skin pale from so much blood loss. A few other guys had homed on her and stood with Vad, laughing and touching her face and hair. She already fed too much today, I said, observing her coloring and complete look of confusion. Greg said, slid his hand behind my neck and turned me back to him. They won't hurt her. We kissed a while longer, and then I felt a tap on my shoulder. Rose. I looked up into Lisa's face. Her anxious expression startled me because I could not feel the emotions behind it. Too much beer for me. I glimpsed off Grio's lab, George's lab. Where are you going? He asked. Be right back. I pulled Lisa aside, suddenly wishing I was sober. What's wrong? Them. She nodded towards the guy with the feeder girl. She still had a group around her. And when she shifted to look at one of them, I was small red wounds scattered on her neck. They were doing a sort of group feeding, taking turns biting her and making gross suggestions. High and obvious, she led them. They cannot do that, Lisa told me. She's a feeder. Nobody is going to stop them. Lisa looked up at me with pleading eyes. Hurt, outrage, and anger filled them. Will you? I could always be the aggressive one, looking after her ever since we were little. Seeing her there now, so upset and looking at me to fix things, was more than I could stand. Giving her a shaky note, I stumbled over to the group. You so desperate to get some that you have got to drug girls now, Vadi? I asked. He glanced up from where he could have been running his lips over the human girl's neck. Why are you done with George and looking for more? I put my hands on my hip and hoped I looked fuzzy. The truth was, I was actually starting to feel a little nauseous from all I could drunk. Are not you enough drunks in the world to get me near you? I told him. A few of his friends laughed. But maybe you can go make out with that lamp over there. It seems to be out of it enough to make you happy. You don't need her anymore. A few other people laughed. It's not any of your business, he hissed. She is just lunch. Referring to feeders as a meal was about the only thing worse than calling Dampier's blood whores. This is not a feeding room. Nobody wants to see this. Yeah, agreed a senior girl. It is gross. A few of her friends agreed. We are glad at all of us. Me, the hardest. Fine, none of you have to see it. Come on, he grabbed the feeder girl's arm and jerked her away. Clumsily, she stumbled along with him out of the room, making soft whimpers noises. Best I could do, I told Lisa. She started at me, shocked. He's just going to take her to his room. He will do even worse things to her. Liz, I don't like it either, but it is not like I can go and chase him down or anything. I rubbed my forehead. I could go punch him or something, but I feel like I'm going to throw up as it is. His face grew dark and she bit her lip. He cannot do that. I'm sorry. I returned to the chair with George, feeling a little bad about what happened. I don't want to see the feeders get taken advantage of any more than Lisa did. It reminded me too much of what a lot of Morai guys thought they could do to Dampier girls. But I also could not win this battle. Not tonight. George had shifted me around to get a better angle on my neck. When I noticed Lisa was gone a few minutes later, practically falling, I climbed off his lap and looked around. Where is Lisa? He reached for me. Probably the bathroom? I could not feel a thing through the bond. The alcohol had numbed me. Stepping out in the hallway, I breathed a sigh of relief at escaping the loud music and voices. It was quiet out here, except for crashing sound. A couple rooms down, the door was ajar. and I pushed my way inside. The feeder girl covered in a corner, terrified, Lisa stood with arms crossed, her face angered and terrible. She was chatting at Weird intently, and he started back. Entranced, he also held a baseball bat, and it looked like he could use it already because the room was thrashed. Bookshelves, the stereo, the mirror. "Break the window too," Lisa told him smoothly. "Come on, it does not matter." Hypnotized, he walked over to the large, tinned window. I started my mouth, nearly hitting the floor, as he pulled back and slammed the bat into glass. It shattered, sending shards everywhere and letting it the early morning light lit, normally kept blocked out. He winced as it shone on his eyes, but he don't move away. "Lisa," I exclaimed, "stop it, make him stop. He should have stopped earlier." I barely recognized the look on Lisa's face. I could have never seen her so upset, and I could certainly never seen her do anything like this. I know what it was, of course. I know right away, compulsion. For all I know, she was seconds away from having him turn the bat on himself. "Please, Lisa, don't do it anymore, please." Through the fuzzy alcoholic buzz, I felt a trickle of emotions that were strong enough to practically knock me down. Black, angry, merciless, starting feeling to be coming from sweet and steady Lisa. I could know her since kindergarten, but in that moment, I barely know her. And I was afraid. "Lisa, please," I repeated. "He's not worth it. Let him go." She don't look at me. Her stormy eyes were focused entirely on Vad. Slowly, carefully, he lifted up the bat, tightening to it so that it lined up with his own skull. "Lisa," I begged. Oh God, I was going to have to tackle her or something to make her stop. "Don't do that." "He should have stopped," Lisa said evenly, the bat quite moving. It was now at exactly the right distance to gain momentum and strike. "He should have done that to her. He should not have done that to her. People cannot treat other people like that, even feeders." "But you're scaring her," I said smoothly. "Look at her." Nothing happened at first. Then Lisa let her gaze flick towards the feeder. The human girl still sat huddled in a corner, arms wrapped around herself protectively. Her eyes were enormous, and light reflected off her wet, tear-steady face. She gave a choked, terrible sob. Lisa's face stayed impulsive. Inside her, I could feel the battle she was wagging for control. Some part of her don't want to hurt Vad, despite the building anger that otherwise filled her. Her face crumpled and she squeezed her eyes shut. Her right hand reached out to her left wrist and clenched it, nails digging deep into flesh. She flinched at the pain, but through the bond, I felt the shock of the pain distract her from Vad. She let go of the compulsion and he dropped the bat. Suddenly looking confused, I let go of the breath I had been holding. In the hallway, footsteps sounded. I could left the door open and the crash had attracted attention. A couple of door room staff members burst into the room, freezing where they saw the destruction in front of them. "What happened?" The rest of us looked at each other. Vad looked completely lost. He started at the room, at the bat, and then at Lisa and me. "I don't know. I cannot." He turned his full attention to me and suddenly grew anger. "What the? It was you. You could not let the feeder thing go." The door room workers looked at me questioningly, and in few seconds, I made up my mind. "We have to protect her. The more she uses it, the worse it will get. Stop her, Rose. Stop her before they notice. Before they notice and take her away too. Get her out of here." I could see Miss Crab face in my mind, pleading frantically. I gave Vad a healthy look, knowing full well no one could question a confusion I made or even suspect Lisa. "Yeah, well, if you could let her go," I told him. "I could not have to do this. Save her from herself." After that night, I never drank again. I refused to let my guard down around Lisa. And 2 days later, while I was supposed to be suspended for destruction of property, I took Lisa and broke out of the academic. Back in Lisa's room, with Alexander's arm around me and her angry and upset eyes on me, I don't know if she could do anything, distract again, but the situation reminded me too much of that one from 2 years ago, and I know I had to defuse it. Just a little blood, Alexander was saying. I won't take much. I just want to see what Dampier's taste is like. Nobody here cares. Alexander, Lisa growled. Leave her alone. I slipped out from under his arm and smiled, looking for a funny retreat rather than one that might start a fight. Come on, I teased. I had to hit the last guy who asked me that. And you're a hell of a lot prettier than Jess. It could be a waste. Pretty? He asked. I'm stunningly sexy, but not pretty. Carly laughed. No, you're pretty. Toad told me you buy some kind of French hair gel. Alexander, distracted, as so many drunk people easily are, turned around to defend his honor. Forgetting me, the tension disappeared and he took the teasing about his hair with a good attitude. Across the room, Lisa met my eyes with relief. She smiled and gave me a small nod of thanks before she returned her attention to Aaron.